since we just talked about the Hetzer, I had an idea. Why not talk about another weird and awkward vehicle? As far as tanks from World War II go, many regard the M3 Medium as one of the worst. At a glance, that statement seems plausible. It looks like it was haphazardly slapped together, and that's honestly not that far off. But you know what they always say, you shouldn't judge a book by its cover. I don't think the M3 was all that bad. In order to explain why, we need to start from the beginning. By 1940, the US realized that their tanks simply weren't good enough. Their mainline medium was the M2, which was essentially a monstrous mass of machine guns. France, regarded as one of if not the strongest military in Europe, had fallen in mere months, taken down largely by German armor. At that point in time, US tanks had anemic guns, specifically 37mm cannons. These obviously would not do. So for future tanks, a 75mm gun was specified. There was one slight issue though. In the United States, no one had tried making a turret for such a large gun. To create a solution, they would need time. In order to buy that time, a stopgap was ordered. They already had experience mounting a 75 in the hull of an M2, so the stopgap would use that method. It would still have a 37, just in a fully rotating turret. The lower hull would essentially just be an M2's, but the upper hull was redesigned, and had far better armor. In fall of 1940, it was accepted as the M3 Medium, but it wouldn't roll off production lines until spring of 1941. Though the M3 looks like a pile of garbage, it was a fairly solid tank overall, one that could go toe-to-toe with German forces in Africa. With the 75, the M3 could outrange the Panzer III's and IVs in use at that time, since they had short-barreled guns. The M3 wasn't as cramped as people make it out to be, but that isn't to say it wasn't cramped in some places. The crew operating the 75 certainly were, but all things considered, it's not all that bad. In the British version, the Grant, they were able to get the crew down to 6 instead of 7. This alone helped alleviate a lot of issues. Though the M3's armor was riveted, it was quite strong. Most German tanks deployed at that time had trouble penetrating it, and that was something a lot of Allied tanks couldn't boast about. Riveted armor can be pretty problematic, as if the plate is struck, the rivets can become projectiles. This happened with high explosive shells more than anything, though it could also happen with machine gun fire. Two variants, the M3A1 and M3A3, had improved hull construction methods, using cast and welded construction respectively. Unfortunately, neither variant was thoroughly produced. It was found that machine gun fire could jam the rotor for the 75, so special shields were made for it. This modification was applied somewhat sporadically, so not every M3 got one. The side escape hatches turned out to be ballistic weak points, so they were often welded shut. On the cast hull M3A1, these were eventually removed entirely. The M3 did have some mechanical issues, though they were relatively minor. The radial engine's average lifespan was fairly short, and this unfortunately wouldn't be fixed for quite some time. Thankfully, replacing it was relatively painless, and they had plenty of spares. The M3A3 replaced the radial with a diesel, but as mentioned earlier, it wasn't produced nearly as much. The suspension was also troubled. It was essentially taken directly from the M2, just modified slightly, and had difficulty coping with the M3's weight. Eventually, the suspension was improved with stronger springs. Against Germany, the M3 wasn't used by the British or the Americans for very long. As soon as the M4 became available, the M3 was phased out fairly quickly. It's not hard to see why. The M4 offered all the advantages of the M3, just without the vast majority of the issues. The M3 continued to see use in the Pacific, as the Japanese armor threat was minimal at best. For dealing with infantry, the M3 had two very powerful tools, 37mm canister shot and 75mm high explosive. Together, these proved invaluable against Japanese infantry, especially in dense foliage. These Pacific M3s were mostly used by British and Indian forces, who operated them until the end of the war. Australian armored units used them until the 1950s, when they were replaced by Centurions. The M3 may have not been in the spotlight for very long, but its usefulness is undeniable, especially when viewed as a basis for other vehicles. Not only was the M4 more or less built off of it, but it was used as a platform for various support vehicles, like self-propelled guns and recovery vehicles. In summary, the M3 definitely had its fair share of problems, but it was designed for a very specific purpose. It gave a much-needed kickstart to Allied armor as a whole. Though it rapidly became outdated, it held the line long enough for better tanks to be made, and continued to serve in the support role after the fact. Sure, it was a little cramped, and had minor mechanical issues, but overall, it was a fairly reliable and hard-hitting tank. It's a tank that I personally don't think gets enough credit. I think that since it looks so awkward, people just assume it's bad, but it pulled its weight and then some. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and I'll see you on the next one.